So when we're talking about food and we're talking about cooking food, one of the activities that I do in the classroom with my students is I start the unit off by asking, why do we cook food? Why don't we just eat all of our food raw? And a lot of the answers that I get from my students usually break down into things like this. Number one, we want to kill the germs and bacteria. Our first unit in class, we discussed the fact that certain foods generally contain and grow and harbor bacteria. We also want to add flavor. A diet of all raw food items would not be very good. Eventually, we would miss what we've come to know as far as flavor goes. We also kind of want to heat the food up. Cold food and nothing but cold food isn't very appetizing. We want to cook food so that we change the color of the food. Some foods we soften because they're hard and would be difficult to eat. Some foods we harden. They're liquid, and when we cook them, they become not liquid anymore. They become more firm. We want to create smells. These get our digestive system going and begin to prepare us to break the food down. And there are some foods that have to be cooked just to make them digestible. So typically in cooking, we create all of these changes by applying heat, one of the three types of heat that we covered. And so the more heat that we apply, the type of heat that we apply, creates these sort of changes in food that we want so that we can eat these food and digest these food items. As demonstrated here in this picture of steak, the more heat sometimes that we add, the more changes that are going to occur. So there's going to be lots of different changes depending on what type of food. Now, when we look at this steak, we are looking at a protein-based food. And proteins are going to change differently than things like starches and waters and fats. So let's talk about that. The first thing we want to talk about and the first term we're looking at here are gelatinize. So starches undergo a process that we call gelatinizing or gelatinization. So essentially, when we're talking about starches, we're talking about grain products, pastas, and starchy vegetables like potatoes. So oatmeal, dried pasta, regular dried pasta, raw potatoes, these things are kind of hard. And when we cook them, rice is a great example, they absorb moisture. So they actually suck moisture in, and this causes the different starch granules to swell up and to soften because the water softens them. This can thicken a liquid. This can take all of the liquid away. When we do pasta, the pasta absorb some of the water, and then we drain off the excess water. When you cook rice, you measure a proper amount of water, and the rice absorbs that water, and then you know that that product is done. So starches gelatinize. That's that process, sucking in the water, swelling and softening. Sugars undergo a process when you apply heat to them called caramelization. So as sugars cook, they turn brown and they change flavor. And this is responsible for most of the flavors associated with cooked foods. So this, the caramelization can actually only occur with dry cooking methods. And we'll get to that in the next lesson. Water will not get hot enough to brown sugars. So essentially, you can boil something all day and it will never turn golden brown and delicious. So when we talk about caramelization, we're talking about this golden brown, delicious goodness of crust. It can go too far and it can be burnt. And there are different levels of caramelization, which we will get into as well. And some of that just comes through practice. So something can be lightly browned, something can be deeply browned, and something can be burnt. Some examples of this are bread crust and cookies. When you cook them and they turn brown, they have sugars and they have components. Meat, which does not contain sugars, it undergoes a different browning process called the Maillard reaction, which we will explore a little bit more in a future lesson. When we apply heat, water evaporates. So all foods typically contain some sort of water, and this evaporation is responsible for the drying of foods during cooking. Now, the drying of foods might be a negative or it might be a positive. A negative would mean I've overcooked my chicken and now my chicken breast is very dry. I lost all of that good moisture and it's all dried out. A positive of water evaporation could be as I cook my chili down or I cook my soup down, it loses water and it concentrates those flavors. So I might start making my chili and it's a little watery and it's a little liquidy and loose. And then when my chili is ready to eat after several hours, it's nice and thick and I have much better and more developed flavors. The next thing that happens when you put heat on food items is that fats are going to melt. So fat in, say, a meat product like ground beef or sausage or bacon, it's going to soften, it's going to liquefy. If you continue to apply heat and too much heat, then you can create smoke and flare-ups and create fires. But ultimately, a lot of fats will heat to high temperatures. So they're used as a medium for actually browning foods. An example of that would be deep frying with French fries. So example of fats melting would be bacon or burger or sausage. You put it into the pan, you can see that the pan was dry, and after a few minutes, there is some liquid, there's some oil in the pan that is now cooking the food item, and your burger or your bacon shrinks down and becomes smaller. So it loses moisture like water and the fats melt out of it and your end product is going to be smaller than the product that you started with. So fats are good for browning foods and fats can also create some loss in foods.